All right, let's try that now. Sorry about that. Think we got the sound back. Looks like we had a unfortunate mute button pushed. Sorry that you didn't get to hear any of the worship. Apologize for that. Let me restart with some of the things that we were talking about. We were talking about last week there was a, really a precious presence of God here. And as we were down in the bookstore, and we began to wait on the Lord for what He was doing, and as we wait now, but I was sharing just recently as we wait on the Lord, what's going on in the spirit. The Lord's positioning angels to come all over, and as we are waiting on Him and working with Him on what He wants to do in the flow. And I was just sharing when the mic was off that that no matter what I prepare, I'm always subject to listen to what God wants to do now. I pray, I fast, I seek God, we come up with different things He wants me to share. But if the Lord at any point in time wants to, change things and move based on maybe who's here or what He wants to do in this hour or who shows up, then definitely submitted to those things. And again, I apologize that we missed the worship. It was a good worship. I love having worship to the Lord. But one of the things that I also want to share before we start is that we live a lifestyle of worship, but sometimes growing up in church, before we get in healing school, it seems like you always need to have worship before God can move. Got to have the musicians, got to have everything set up. And I can't find one time where Jesus had musicians before He did miracles. It's not a prerequisite. I believe we come through all the foundations of the Old Testament and all the things that God has shared about praise and worship. And I'm not negating those things in any way, but I also want to state a truth that as long as you have Jesus, that's all you need. And the Lord Jesus, working through His Spirit and the will of the Father, definitely, if He's there, healing, miracles, signs, wonders will happen. And so we are moving to letting God move and do what He wants to do. And so I want to do some recaps. Hi, Benjamin was the was the mic on when I was talking about the announcements? No? Okay. All right, sorry about that. I had to check real fast. But before we go forward, we've been in a session talking about healing school and signs, wonders, and miracles. And in the healing school that God's told us to do, He said that on Thursday there's going to be a special anointing here. So in this anointing that God has given us, I want to be respectful for what God wants to do in that anointing for healing. So whether you're here, whether you're online, I believe the Lord, there's no distance with God in the sense of the Spirit where He can touch anybody, anywhere, anytime. And so if you're watching online, just be open to the moving of God. And what we're going to be doing here today is we're going to be continuing on the series on Healing School. Last session I talked about encountering Jesus. Without Jesus, how are you going to get healing? And so I was sharing a lot of different things about that. So we're going to do some recap before we start into this next session. If you're watching online, you can already see that I put in there this session number two as Jesus, the Everlasting Father. I was sharing about before we go and look for healing in my own life, I had read everything I could get about healing, everything I could get on signs, wonders, and miracles. And what I found is I didn't find it as much as I thought I was going to. But when I started wondering about finding Jesus and encountering Jesus, I began to experience healing and miracles and different things. And what I am finding is healing is a byproduct of Jesus in the sense that it flows from Him. But if I'm looking for something else, I'm looking for something that's flowing from him. I can miss Jesus. I can miss who I'm supposed to keep my eyes on. And as I begin to walk in this vein where I was like, all right, Lord, show me about you. I shared last time about an interesting statement in the Bible that Paul had preached, and that was, all I want to know is Jesus Christ and him crucified. That intrigued me, and I began to go on the same journey. What is it about Jesus and him crucified that Paul, a man who knew the scripture, a man encountered Jesus many times and seen many miracles, and even had we read about in Ephesus, you know, that unusual miracles were done through the hands of Paul. He had these encounters with God, but yet he still wanted to know Jesus Christ and him crucified. What is it about this man, the Son of God, that we know that intrigued Paul? And what I have found is Jesus is everything. And Jesus didn't just come to heal. He came to do many things. But we are talking about healing. We have come to get healing. This is what God wants to do. And every time I find in the scriptures, as I'm reading things about Jesus, you can't go too far before someone gets healed. You find someone encountering the healer. Someone's faith to reach out and grab the hem of his garment. We talked about that last time. And she was healed. What is it about Jesus that brings about healing? And I had shared last time, Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. And this time we're going to be talking about Jesus, the everlasting Father. And as we're getting into that, I was stating before how I wanted to go through and do kind of a recap of these different things. But going back to, we're going to go back to the standard of Jesus. For so long we have been without the standard. We have said, okay, well, we had a great sermon, but where's the Lord? You know, and sometimes it's been like, what I mean by where's the Lord, what I have found is I can go to a lot of sermons and never experience the manifestation of Christ, like he says in the scripture. And we've been so used to that, wise words and going to services, and that just seems like, okay, well, we don't necessarily know what's going on, but this is kind of how it's been. But the Lord doesn't want to leave us there anymore. It's not good enough for this end time. And Jesus wants us to go back to his standard. And I'm going to share these three things that I believe the Lord has taken us back to. It's the standard of Jesus. And he says John 10, 37 through 38. And I'm not going to read all of them. I'm just going to kind of go through since we've been through them all. But if this is your first time watching online, I'm going to go through these pillars of things that we're building on, these foundational pieces of what God wants to do in this end time. And John 10, 37 through 38, it says, if I do not do the works of my Father, do not believe me. But if I do, though you do not believe me, believe the works, that you may know and believe that the Father is in me and I in him. And then John 14, 10 through 12 says, do you not believe that I am in the Father in me? The words that I speak to you, I do not speak on my own authority, but the Father who dwells in me does the works. Believe me that I am in my Father, and the Father in me, or else believe for the sakes of the works themselves. Most assuredly I say to you, he who believes in me, the works that I do, he will do also, and greater works than these he will do, because I go to my Father. Jesus said that if I didn't do the works of my Father, and it's just not works of preaching the gospel and feeding the poor and doing those different things, it's the works of power, healing, signs, and wonders. If I didn't do these things, you don't have to believe me. He actually excused them from believing. Now, it's been a long time since I've been in a service. And now, you know, with listening to Pastor Johan online, I've been in some services. But where it says, if I don't do the works and the works of Jesus are not manifest here, you don't even have to believe. That's not usually what you're told when you're taught about evangelism. That it's so important that the message and the manifestations are both present. But returning to this standard and what God wants us to do as we prepare for the outpouring coming in July, as we're preparing for the third great awakening, what I believe the Lord is positioning for is get ready. We're going to get built up. I talked Sunday about getting equipped, that the Lord wants to equip us for the work of the ministry. And so there's a time and a season to sit at the feet of Jesus and to find out what the hope of our calling is. So that when we are to go out and proclaim this wonderful message about what Jesus has done, we are built up. We have the manifestation of Jesus that comes with the message of Jesus. And so that was the first one that we're returning back to, is the standard of Jesus. The second one, Paul reiterates this point. He talks about not coming in wise words, but in power. And in 1 Corinthians 4, 19 through 20, I'm just going to read 20 right now. It says, "For the kingdom of God is not in word, but in power." So we're looking at healing school to say, okay, Lord, come in power. And I believe that's just what he's going to do. If you're watching online, if you're here today, the Lord is going to be doing a work of healing. And eventually, as we grow, there's going to be creative miracles, and there's going to be DNA healings. There's going to be all kinds of things that we've only read about in the Bible. Some things we've heard about. But there's coming a time, and it's coming quickly, where we're going to see it. We're going to experience what God has said. And the third one is lifting up Jesus. John 12:32 says, "And if I am lifted up from the earth, will draw all people to myself." As we lift up Jesus, he's going to bring everyone in. He's going to bring in the multitudes. Talks in Acts, it's written there where it says that the Lord added daily such as should be saved. See, when we work with Jesus, he adds to his own church that which should be saved. Those who he has prepared. Those who he's gotten ready. And the Lord's the one who adds to the church daily. So we're getting in agreement with Jesus and what he wants to do here in July by obeying him, by doing this healing school and preparing for the outpouring, the first measure of that outpouring that's coming. And so as we've been positioning ourselves in this healing school, waiting on the Lord for that special presence that's here, because there's the angels of God in this place. I see the Lord here with us today, and not only that, his angels, he's positioned at different places. And so, it's kind of empty in here right now. And I was sitting there and I'm like, Lord, I see these things. And where are the people? And there's people here, I'm not saying, but we were in this big old room. We're preparing. And so our faith is out there right now, believe in the Lord, as we're getting everything ready, because I've seen in this place it completely filled up in people coming to Jesus and coming down to the altar and crying out to Jesus, saying, "What should I do to be saved?" And I've seen the Lord healing people and doing all kinds of things here. And so sometimes we all go through a thing called a test of faith, which I was talking about, and I've been talking about this test of faith. What is it about a test of faith? And we're preparing for this time in the season. God is bringing in the multitudes. And so I see it in the spirit. We walk by faith, not by sight. And I just want to encourage everyone, especially the church here and online, that what the Lord said he's going to do, he's going to do. And so I spend a lot of time praying and asking God, talking about praying into the vision, praying into these different things, because we're preparing for a time. Jesus has given instructions that we're not to be praying as in, "Oh, God, please, would you do what we thought you said you're going to do?" And you sit there and pray for that. "Oh, God, maybe you can," that's not how he's telling us to pray. What he's telling us to pray is praying it through. "Lord, you said you're going to do this. We put you in remembrance of your word, and we're believing you that you're going to do this outpouring. So we're praying it through. We're praying these things according to your word, and we're putting you in remembrance of your word. And we're setting the stage. We're setting the things that you said to do. We're getting in the word of God in prayer. Tonight we're focusing on the word aspect through healing. And then Fridays we do focus on the prayer aspect of things. And then Sundays we focus on the structure, building the church. And so as we're getting in these things, you'll notice that I build kind of off each other, and I kind of reference different things from those services. So everything's free online. You're welcome to watch it. And we have set up those different things so you can access it for free. But I want to first talk to you tonight. This is the session number 2. About Jesus, the everlasting Father. As I've grown in the aspects of finding out who Jesus is, knowing Jesus Christ and Him crucified, I wasn't originally seeking for to know Him that way. What I was seeking for was healing. I've been born again and I wanted to be free. I'd seen it in the Bible, but the Lord began to take me on a journey. And this is what I believe the Lord has been instructing me to do is take you on this journey with me that I've been on. We've all been through different things, and if you've never been through a healing teaching or at the church, I've been through so many of them. So when I was coming to pray and asking God, what do I share? I felt like He said, I'm going to take them through the same thing that I was taking you through. And so I'm going to be sharing my life with you as a testimony and a witness of the faithfulness of Christ and Jesus the healer. But also learning about Jesus, because healing is part of what belongs to us, but He just doesn't want us to stay there. Sometimes we get our healing. It's like, yeah, I'm healed. Thank you, Jesus. And now it's like we kind of just go off, go away. But when I got healed, and I was sharing last time about my shoulder. When I got healed, it wasn't, oh, Lord, thank you for my healing. I'm just going to go about my way and just kind of live the same. No, it set a fire inside my bones. Something happened to me. When I tasted and I saw that the Lord was good, there was faith infused in me that the Lord is the healer. Because I had read the Bible so many times, different sections. I've seen the wonderful miracles of God, and I've seen these different things. And I felt like at the time I was like Gideon. You know, I was waiting and hiding, trying to, you know, just make it by. And then the Lord came in and He asked the question to this angel. He says, where are the wonders that we heard about God and, you know, in Egypt and before from our fathers? Where are these things? And I believe the people of God have asked this question. We've heard about Jesus. We've heard about the end time work. When is it going to be? What are the season? Where is the God of the Bible? You know, I've heard about different miracles and I've gone to different services to experience them. And then you go there and you don't, and you're like, oh man, well, I was disappointed. And so a lot of people have done the same thing. But when I came to find Jesus, not the miracles, I was not disappointed. Then I started entering into the things that He said, the things that I've read about Him in the Bible. I began to experience the miracles. And in this outpouring, we're going to experience miracles and signs and wonders. If you wonder why I repeat a lot of different things, is sometimes in my own life, I have found that I need some repetition in order to get it. I need some repetition in order to believe it. That's why in the Bible, it talks about Psalms 1, to meditate on God's word day and night. There's a time when we have to meditate on things, speak it out day and night, so that we get the word of God into our hearts, into our spirits, to get built up. And then a day comes when we're able to decree the word of God and release what God has put into us through meditating on His word and release it out and see the thing that God has said. Man, it's another unusual presence tonight. I was wondering how God was going to move. Thank you, Jesus. I feel like in my heart that what the Lord is also doing tonight is He's beginning to break off the spirit of doubt and disbelief or unbelief. I believe the Lord is starting to break that spirit off our culture and off of people in America and throughout the world. There's a breaking that has to start. And then as we begin to experience this breaking, it's like a domino effect, because the Spirit of God is going to bring in faith to believe Jesus. And I wasn't going to talk about the spirit of doubt today, because I wasn't sure how the Lord wanted to necessarily move in that, but I want to bring it up, the doubt of people. And I was going to do a lot more recap, but I feel like the Lord is moving us somewhere else. We're going to go ahead and turn to Mark 6, verse 6. And I'm going to read this scripture. We're going to probably read a little bit more of that, but I want to focus on this one right now as the Spirit's leading me. It says, and he marveled because of their unbelief. And then it says, then he went about the villages in the circuit teaching. When I've heard at different times that, you know, preaching about this account, and I'm going to start in verse 1, but I want you to focus on this here. We see that Jesus marveled at their unbelief, and then he went about the villages in the circuit teaching. This is a key to some of this breakthrough that we're looking for, or asking God for. So in chapter or verse 1, we're going to go back. It says, then he went out from there and came to his own country, and his disciples followed him. And when the Sabbath had come, he began to teach in the synagogue. And many hearing him were astonished, saying, where did this man get these things? And what wisdom is this which is given to him, that such mighty works are performed by his hands? Is this not the carpenter, the son of Mary, and the brother of James and Joses and Judas and Simon? And are not his sisters here with us? So they were offended at him. But Jesus said to them, a prophet is not without honor except in his own country, among his own relatives, and in his own house. And then it says in verse 5, now he could do no mighty works there except that he laid his hands on a few sick people and healed them. Now, what I believe the Lord is showing us here is that there is really this spirit of unbelief. They were offended at Jesus. Now, I don't know about you, but have you ever tried to pray for someone who's offended with Jesus? Man, it's really pretty hard to get things going. It's difficult when people are offended with Jesus. I don't believe that was just for that time, because if you ever went out and shared the love of Christ with someone, there's sometimes people who are angry and offended. And I've seen a lot of times even people who go to church, because I've been one of them, angry and offended at Jesus because of whatever reason. And so in my own life, I had to get that right with the Lord. But you know what God did in so many times is he began to send people to speak to me truth over and over and over, till one day I had to know for myself who this man, who Jesus really is, because I had him as my Savior, had him as my Lord, to a measure. A lot of times we have Jesus as our Savior. Lord, thank you, I'm not going to hell. Woo! But when it comes to Lordship, we like to take that hat. I did for so much time, where I was like, all right, well, today I'm doing what I want to do. Lord, I'm doing what I want to do. And thank you for salvation. Bless what I want to do. And God wasn't okay with that. But as we see, there's people that are offended with Jesus. That really hinders this atmosphere. Jesus talked about, you know, prophets without honor except in his own country, among his own relatives, in his own house, is not without honor. But we see there's this dynamic of atmosphere that Jesus had with these people in this place. And we see that there was offense at him. But Jesus was able still to do some works. He was able to heal a few sick people, but makes this comment of he was able to do no mighty work. What I find interesting about that is we can look at it a couple different ways. Some people, you know, I've heard different teaching on this, and I agree with a lot of it, but there's an aspect of he couldn't do mighty works. I ask myself, why? Was it because there wasn't enough power? Well, we know Jesus was filled with power. No, we see that there's this unbelief that's present. But when we see verse 5, except that he laid his hands on a few sick people and healed them, the question come to my mind is this. Where were all the people that usually come to Jesus? See, when you're offended at somebody, you don't go to them. I believe that a lot of people, and what the scripture is saying, that a lot of people, they didn't believe him, they were offended, so they never came near where Jesus was, except for a few. And I believe these people just were like, well, you know, hey, might as well go see what's going on. And Jesus still healed those people. But where were the other ones? Where he couldn't do any mighty works. Looks like a lot of people weren't turning out to come meet Jesus. And so, as the Lord's been bringing up this, combating the spirit of unbelief, you know, Jesus marvels at these people's unbelief, that they didn't even come to him. I believe they didn't even show up. They just were offended. But Jesus did something. He responded to that. So he started off teaching. And then when it was like he was rejected, because he was, you know, he didn't do any mighty works there except to heal a few sick people, he went about again teaching. I believe this is a key to what God wants to do. We're going to have a time where we go and we teach. People are going to be offended. That's okay. Because we're going to go and we're going to teach again. We might only be able to do a little bit here and there, but we're going to take every opportunity that God gives us to do his work. And so as we see the model of Jesus, he didn't stop teaching just because people were not believing. In fact, he went on a circuit, which is an interesting word, because that circuit, you know, it gives this picture of he's going and preaching, he's going and preaching, he's going and preaching, he's going and preaching, he's going and preaching. He's going here, he's going there, he's going to preach the gospel of the kingdom, telling people these wonderful works that they were talking about in verse 6, because they asked this question, where did this man get these things? And what wisdom in which is given to him that such mighty works are performed by his hands? I find that astonishing that he's doing mighty works. They're acknowledging this fact, but yet these people still wouldn't come to him. Other people were saying about Jesus, where was he getting this? What wisdom does he have? And still people aren't believing. There's a spirit that has to be broken, and it's broken through the teaching of the word. Jesus' response was, I'm going to teach the word. And so as we begin to start healing school, session number 2, we're finding that there is sometimes opposition of unbelief that can come out of offense. It can come out of many other things, but there's this unbelief that is hindering what God wants to do for people because they just don't come to him. Now, I believe there's probably some other people who came, but they were unbelieving and they had this resistance against Jesus, and so he only healed those people he was, you know, that came to him. The reason why I believe the Lord is bringing this up is because this time and hour that we're coming to, you'll notice there's some reactions that are going to happen. There's going to be those who are angry and offended. And then there's those who are going to come. And, you know, I just pray that if anger does come up in your heart, that you take a break and just ask the Lord to show me what he's doing. But if you're coming to the Lord to be healed or to position yourself to minister healing as the times come on, as we listen, you know, because I believe this will be listened to as we grow on how to minister and how to walk in healing and signs and wonders as we get into those things. But this is going to build and keep building. But we need to know that there's resistance of what the enemy doesn't want us to do through this unbelief. And we got to break that thing. And we are going to break that thing. We were told, you know, I've been preaching about Ephesus, and we've been in Acts chapter 19, and we're going back and forth and looking at different aspects of things. And as we've been doing that, one of the big things is in Acts chapter 19, verse 20, we're going to turn to that because I want you to see it again. That there's a process of teaching the word before there is an outpouring of the move of God. You see in verse 10, actually, we're going to go in verse 10, it says, "And this continued for 2 years, so that all who dwelt in Asia heard the word of the Lord Jesus, both Jew and Greeks." So there was some teaching going on for 2 years before we see in verse 11, "Now God worked unusual miracles by the hands of Paul." And then we're going to skip down to verse 20. "So the word of the Lord grew mightily and prevailed." There is a prevailing of the word of God. There is the word growing mightily that needs to happen in an area and in a section for mighty works to be done. We're not only going to just pray, because there's an aspect of prayer that needs to happen, but there's an aspect of teaching and preaching the word of God. And so we're going to get to this place, and this is what I've been believing and asking God, and this is the things that I believe that Lord wants. We're known as Ephesus number 2, and if you haven't seen that sermon, please look it up. But the Lord has put Ephesus for a model of what we're this church here in D.C. And so I like to look through all these different things and get it in this so that we know our DNA here. What's the calling? What's the atmosphere of what God wants to do here? And so when I see the word of the Lord grew mightily and prevailed, it's like one of those mission statements that I just have to see happen, because that's what God wants to do here. He wants the word of God to grow mightily and to prevail here so that it begins to spread as the third great awakening begins to happen. The word has to grow mightily. You see Jesus going about preaching the gospel. You see the apostles preaching the gospel. You see Paul in Ephesus preaching the gospel, teaching about Jesus. And then we see a great move of the Lord happen. That was also tied with prayer. I don't want to leave that out. There's an aspect of prayer where they were praying and preaching, praying and preaching, praying and preaching. And then they begin to see the things of God. Jesus began to manifest himself in great ways. But God wants us to focus tonight, as he's changed up some of my sermon and how I was going to deliver it. He wants us to focus on breaking the spirit of unbelief in our own lives. There comes a point before we can go out, we need to conquer it ourselves. We need to have an encounter ourselves of breaking the spirit of unbelief that might be in our own life. When I began to encounter Jesus, Jesus began to challenge me through the scripture in his word about my preconceived notions, about my doubts and my unbeliefs, and about things in my heart that I was like, well, I don't know about that, God. Because sometimes you read the scriptures and it's so wonderful, it's hard to believe. But the Lord wants us to believe his word. He wants us to experience his word. And we're going to do that through Jesus. So the first point that I'm going to have tonight is breaking the spirit of unbelief in our own lives. In healing, I talked about before that there's usually two rivers two aspects of how we can receive healing. One of them is through personal faith. The other is through the anointing. And when I talk about the anointing, I mean the gifts of the Spirit are manifested through someone else to come and touch us and we receive healing. But we're going to talk about tonight the river of personal faith for believing God. Because I believe as we begin to grow in our understanding and the knowledge of Jesus Christ, in being in his presence and hearing about how he interacted, that the life of Jesus comes and begins to touch our bodies and to heal us. There's a scripture that says, Jesus has come to set the captives free, to heal the brokenhearted, proclaim the favorable year of the Lord. Sometimes we are held captive by our belief or our disbelief. Sometimes we have a measure of faith, but corresponding unbelief that hinders the flow of what God wants to do in our lives. I want to turn really fast because our point number two, see, point number one is we got to break the spirit of unbelief in our life. We do that through the Word of God, the teaching that Jesus had modeled for us. He immediately went out and he taught in a circuit. So we need to break that unbelief with the teaching of God's word so that the word of God comes in our lives where it becomes mighty, it grows mightily, and it prevails in us. We see this happening in Ephesus, but something had to happen first in the individuals for it to pour out. So we're going to talk about, so that was the first point, is breaking the spirit of unbelief in our life, getting the word of God into us, so that we can have the word come to such a measure that it breaks that spirit of unbelief. It prevails. What is the word of God prevailing over? Well, it's prevailing over the lies of the enemy. Because there is, we're not going to go too much deep in there. There is a word of the enemy. There's a logos of the enemy if you look in the Bible, and we'll revisit that later. But there is a logos of the enemy, which is the word of the enemy that comes. And when people believe that word, it creates a stronghold. It's a lie of the enemy. If that stronghold is there and you're coming to bring truth, well, the word of God, the logos of God, has to prevail against that lie of the enemy. So we got to break that first of all. And we're going to do that through the word. Then I mentioned about how sometimes we have in our lives, point number two, is we don't have full amount of unbelief. We have some faith, but there's a hindrance that happens. And we're going to talk about this hindrance that happens to believing. So I'm going to go ahead and we're going to turn. We're going to turn to 1 Thessalonians 3:10. This is an interesting scripture that the Lord spoke to my heart. And I'm going to read it for you. It says, night and day praying exceedingly that we may see your face and perfect what is lacking in your faith. I'm going to stop there. A lot of times we're told we don't have faith. Well, if you have a measure of Christ in your life, I believe you have some faith. But sometimes we have our faith that's not perfected yet. And so, I don't know about you, but I've been in situations where my faith has not been perfected and I went to stand on the word of God for healing or for breakthrough, and I've experienced a lot of pain and suffering because I had something lacking in my faith, something that wasn't complete yet. But the circumstance at hand happened anyway. And I asked God a lot of questions about that. You know, Pastor Johann has shared a lot of my life. I don't mind being on display. I like being real with people. I like to know that, you know, I've struggled. We've gone through different things. And the reason why this scripture is so near and dear to me is because when you're trying to believe God and you may not have been built up yet, you might have some things lacking in your faith, but you're doing the best you know how to do. And you're in the situation where something happens and there's a loss. And I'll go ahead. I was debating whether I was going to share this right now, but I feel led to do it. So, Lord, I'm going to just submit to you, because sometimes it's hard to talk about situations of pain that you've gone through, different failures. And I believe the Lord is going to use my failures to help you. And what I mean by failures is sometimes in our test of faith, we didn't know we were lacking something, and we come short. Or there's not someone there to pray James 5, the prayer of faith, for us. And I'm sure a lot of us has been there. Where the Lord says, you know, is anyone sick, let them call on the elders of the church and let them pray over them in the name of the Lord, and the prayer of faith shall save the sick, and the Lord will raise them up. I got that in my spirits very strongly, because I believe that when you call on a man or woman of God to pray the prayer of faith over someone, that the Lord is supposed to raise them up. Now, unless God gives something different, like someone is supposed to go home, it's their time. They had their, you know, their long life and they are ready to go home. I don't believe they should go sick, but if they're ready to go home, we'll let them go. We work with those things. But I believe if someone is sick and wants to be healed and they are lacking something in their faith, there should be someone there available for them to be able to receive what they're lacking. And so the Lord has made it very clear that He has provided in the body of Christ people, elders, leaders, for those who are lacking. And in verse 10, I'll read it again now. Night and day, praying exceedingly that we may see your face and perfect what is lacking in your faith. One of the things God has been showing me is, as a leader, I have a responsibility to pray for those that God has put for me to help and to help teach and that are underneath me. And if I don't do my job, and we don't do our job as leaders, that people can suffer things that they wouldn't necessarily have to had suffered if we would have been praying. And that's a heavy responsibility as a leader. Paul says, and I had read before in Galatians 4:19, that I travail again for you in prayer till Christ be established in you. I don't know about you, I've seen a lot of times when people have come in, they got born again, and they never progressed or they've grown, and they kind of go out. And it's kind of like they're forgotten. The Lord doesn't want them to be forgotten. As a leader, we see that Paul's talking here in Thessalonians that they're praying exceedingly night and day. Why? Well, so that they may see your face. Sometimes people don't come to church. They might be discouraged, lacking something in their faith. And well, he's praying to see their face. Now, I know there was a time gap or in this passage of scripture, they weren't near him, so he's praying to see him again. But I believe this is also giving another truth here about praying to see people, where they need to be with you and together in the body. But he's praying night and day exceedingly so that they may perfect what's lacking in their faith. So we see that as something that we need to be doing for others. Praying. See what's lacking. If you're lacking in some of your faith, you know, sometimes I've heard people, you know, tell me, you know, and, you know, they're saying, man, I feel like I'm getting beat up because I don't have enough faith. I feel like I'm getting beat up here. I don't know what else to do. I've been in the same place. So I want to be very gentle with you if you feel like that. I'm not trying to make you feel that way. But what I am going to try to do is I'm going to try to to bring you to the place to where if you have experienced great suffering because there was something lacking in your faith, that the Lord doesn't want you to be there anymore. That there are men and women of God that He wants to bring you in contact with, especially in this move, you're definitely welcome to come, that we'll pray for you. We'll pray that what may be lacking in your faith, that it is perfected. The other thing we're going to pray is we're going to travail in prayer again until Christ be established in you. There's a process of prayer that we have to have with the Word. And sometimes we suffer great loss because we just don't know. I shared it last time, my people perish for lack of knowledge because they have rejected knowledge. It's part of that. There's parts where we reject things and there's other parts where we just don't know. But God doesn't want us to be unaware. He wants us to be fed on the good Word. And He also wants the church to be established so that leadership and those that are around one another are praying exceedingly for the things that are lacking in one another's faith so that it's perfected until Christ is established in us. So let me share my testimony here. I was one day found out that my wife was going to have, we're going to have another baby because we're excited. I mean, you know, when you find out you're having a baby, you know, I mean, sometimes there's all kinds of different reactions, but I was excited. Like, yeah, another baby. Awesome. Blessing of the Lord. I love kids. Grow up in a big family. I'm second of nine. That's right. Nine people. Second of nine. So I was never alone. Sometimes I was like, oh, Lord God, please let me get alone. But, you know, so the Lord blessed us with a baby. You know, we got the pregnancy test. We're getting everything ready. And we've already gone through a lot of struggles in that area as far as believing God. But I feel that I'm going to share this aspect because this is where the Lord gave me this word. So one day my wife starts bleeding. And long story short, you know, we go to the doctor and there's nothing they can do. And I'm praying and asking God. I'm standing in faith. I'm encouraging my wife as much as I can. What do I know how to? We sharing the good word and standing on all the scriptures I know. And she has a miscarriage anyways. Now, I shared last time about my daughter who had been in the NICU knowing this isn't how it's supposed to be, Father. I know that You're God of the Word. I see that people are healed. I see Jesus going out, healing the lame, the blind, the maimed, and many others. So in the NICU, I came to a place, you know, back in around 2009, I came to this place where I was searching to know the power of God. And then I'm on this journey to discover the power of God manifested in the manifestation of Jesus. And I'm standing on the Word. I'm meditating on His Word day and night. I mean, hours. Hours in the Word. I mean, 5 hours a day at times. And if I could get more time in, I would. That's just meditating on the Word. That's not including prayer. And I was trying to encounter God and do everything I know to do. And yet, we had a miscarriage. Now, a lot of times when you're talking about healing and you're trying to build faith and you talk about a loss, it can be you know, sometimes you're like, why are you sharing that? And I was like, you know, why am I sharing this? Well, I'm sharing it for this reason. Because in verse 10, because I had a hard time with the Lord with that one. I said, God, you know, I'm going to give this to You. Because I had seen someone be healed before as I prayed for them. I watched them instantly healed. And I said, I was like, Lord, you know, what happened? And so I began to go on another searching because you know, it's like one of those tests of faith. Are you going to believe your circumstance, your experience, or are you going to believe the Word? Well, I knew in the scripture it said the Word of God cannot be broken. So I was like, Lord's Word, You're perfect. Cannot be broken. Okay. So obviously there's something wrong on my side. Now, it's kind of hard to take responsibility for some things because there's many different causes. Now, you know, I want to go ahead and put it there. There's different causes of things, which I found out a few of them later. But I was in this place where I was like, Lord, I thought I had faith. Now, if you've been in church long enough in any kind of leadership or praying for anyone, a lot of times you think you have faith. Well, you do. This scripture right here says you could have faith, but there might be something lacking in it. I don't know how long it took me because there's things that I've experienced with God, and I said, okay, Lord, I don't understand. I'm not in a place to hear it because I'm so upset, so bothered. And I don't know what happened, but I'm going to give it to you so that I can work all this stuff out, but I'm still going to believe your word. I'm going to stand on it so that, because I know the scripture, I'd believe it. That's the word of God. Because if I can't believe the word of God for what he says for healing, how can I believe to be saved? I mean, I'm a pretty logical person. I'd shared before about being a financial analyst. To me, if you can't believe the whole entirety of God's word, then how can you believe God to be saved? Because it's all based in the scripture. So I was like, all right, I'm going to believe your word, Lord. I don't know what happened, but I'm just going to trust you anyways, because me and Jesus would go back a long ways. Just because I've experienced some disappointments and some losses of battles doesn't mean I'm going to chunk the Lord. Because I had done that before. I was so angry with him. I was like, all I want from you is salvation. But I really wanted to know God. But I had gotten over that and come to a place where I belonged to the Lord. So I was like, Lord, I don't know what happened, but here I am. I humble myself before you. And at the right time that I'm ready and you're ready to show me what happened, I'm going to ask you that you show me. But I'm going to believe you anyways. So then over a course of time, I don't know how many months it was, I was going through because I was searching the scripture. I wanted to know what happened. I wanted to say, okay, Lord, if I'm ever in that situation again, what is it I need to do? So the Lord gave me this scripture, night and day, praying exceedingly that we may see your face and perfect what is lacking in your faith. Because I was kind of devastated. Really, I was. You know, I went from being a man who prayed for someone and watching them be healed, and that man of faith who's standing on the word and proclaiming the gospel of God, to proclaiming that Jesus Christ is the healer. And then I experienced this loss. I said, oh, Lord, I know it wasn't with you. What did I do wrong? And it wasn't necessarily that I did something wrong in that sense, but he showed me the scripture. There was something lacking in my faith. And so I've determined in my life that I wouldn't have anything lacking, and that if I ever be in a situation that I could help someone else. So I took this scripture and began to look at perfecting my faith. We read before in Ephesians 4 about perfecting faith. And I think it's Ephesians 4. Let me see real quick. Because we go through a lot of scripture. Well, I'll find that soon enough. But we're talking about equipping the saints for the work of the ministry. But till we all come to one faith. And that's in verse 5. And with we all come to one faith, I believe that's giving this picture of a perfect faith. And so when I was asking the Lord about, and the Lord has shown me about perfecting that which was lacking in my faith, I began to say, okay, Lord, take me on this journey. Take me on this journey. show me what's lacking in my faith. And so this is when this next scripture became very, very important to me. What? Ephesians 4:13. Okay. 4:13. Okay, there we go. I say in Ephesians 4:13, unity of faith. Let me go back to this one scripture. There's a place, as I was going through this pain and suffering, my wife had just lost a child. It wasn't necessarily an easy miscarriage. None of them are, but just how the thing ended up happening. But praying, because when my life started bleeding, and we went to prayer and fasting and just asking God for mercy. And he's still merciful. But I found that there's something lacking in my faith, and so I began to go on a journey. And for a while, I kind of stepped back from this boldness of knowing that Jesus is the healer. It's going through a test of faith. And this wasn't the first one. I don't know if I'll share this today, but I've gone through many trials of disappointment and what I would say losing battles because I didn't know how to fight them. And then the Lord showed me a few things, so we'll talk about some stuff later on, but this is what I wanted to share with you. We're going to go to, this is where we're going to turn first, John 14:18. Now this is a kind of a short scripture, but in John 14:18, it's pretty profound. And I chewed on it a lot. And the Lord gave me a lot of revelation about it. But it says in verse 18, I will not leave you as orphans, I will come to you. Now when you just have a loss of a child, and let me tell you, it wasn't God's perfect will. God wasn't trying to teach me something. Heard that one before. Or he just needed another angel in heaven. Really. He's got myriads and myriads. Why did he need my baby? No, that wasn't the case. No, the enemy came and he came to steal, kill, and to destroy. Jesus came that he would give life and life more abundantly. So as I was going through this scenario of waiting on God, he gave me this scripture. He brought it up again. I will not leave you orphans. I will come to you. Because let me tell you, when you're in that situation and you experience that loss, you think, you feel, man, Lord, I feel like an orphan. Where were you? Well, God was with me. But some things I experienced is because I didn't know. I had something lacking in my faith. And there wasn't the ability to count on someone to help me in that situation. To bring that breakthrough. And honestly, when I look back at it and I asked God about these different things, it was an attack of the enemy. And at that point in time, I wasn't ready for it. I had an open door I didn't realize, and the Lord helped me with that. But he began to provide teachers and people teaching the good word so that I could perfect what was lacking in my faith. But he didn't just leave me there. When he said, I will not leave you as an orphan, what's powerful about the scripture is he began to take me through and show me about orphans, asking me questions. One of the questions was this. Do good fathers leave their children on the ground and dirty with a scraped up knee, forlorn, abandoned? And I said, well, no. He said, I'm not going to leave you like that. And we're going to turn to the reason why I called this session, title that, Jesus, the Everlasting Father. We're going to turn to Isaiah 9, verse 6. It is because I begin to know the Lord as the Father, but Jesus is known as the Everlasting Father. We read in verse 6, it says, for unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government will be on his shoulders, or his shoulder. His name will be called Wonderful, Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. See, one of the titles of Jesus is Everlasting Father. Then we find in chapter 14, verse 18, where he says, I will not leave you orphans, I will come to you. When I begin to see this aspect of things, I begin to see Jesus as my everlasting Father. Now I know there's some doctrinal things, you know, but this is a title that's given to Jesus. I will not leave you as an orphan. We need a father. Someone to help take care of us in that time of need. And Jesus comes and he says, I'm the everlasting Father. I'm not going to leave you as an orphan. I'm not going to leave you forlorn by yourself. I'm not going to leave you in this place. I will come to you. You know, right now I feel like there's a lot of people that are watching online and you've been in this place where you feel like God has left you, but he's not. He said in his word, I will not leave you as an orphan. I will come to you. Jesus is looking to encounter you. He's looking to take you from a place as an orphan to a place as a son or a daughter. See, good fathers, they take care of their children. If they're hurt, they get them fixed up. If they're hungry, they give them food. If they're lacking something, they provide. See, Jesus provided. Jesus took this scripture and my disappointment and the attack of the enemy that got in, and he began to provide. I share this because there's good news. One day I was praying and crying out to God because I believed he's the healer. I still do, and I did then. But I was hurting because I didn't understand. And so there's a scripture that talks about he takes, you know, beauty and or takes ashes and makes them beautiful, or beauty for ashes. And he turns out all things good for those who love him and are called according to his purpose. And we find out in John chapter 14, verse 21, he who has my commands and keeps them, it's he who loves me. And he who loves me will be loved by my Father, and I will love him and manifest myself to him. So I knew this scripture in 21. But the Lord was highlighting verse 18. So I began to get into the word and obey it the best I knew how because I love God. And one day, the Lord took me. He took me up to heaven. And Pastor Johan was there also. And he brought my little girl out to me. We call her Faith. So we named our baby. She had dark hair and she came up and gave me a hug and said, Daddy, I love you. And I began to weep. And even now I feel it, you know. And the Lord began to heal me. The Lord began to give me visions and dreams to help me. He didn't leave me as an orphan. And so as I begin to cry, holding my daughter. The time came, you know, and I got to hold her and worship before my God in heavenly places in the throne. And And I worshiped and I worshiped, holding my daughter, dancing her around in heaven, because I do with all my children. I dance them around as we worship Jesus, because I want them to know that we're first worshipers. And so I was able to do this with this child. Thank you, Jesus. And Jesus began to heal my heart. And I feel right now there's a lot of people who have lost, maybe like me. And the Lord wants to heal the brokenhearted. So I'm going to take a moment just to pray before we move on. Father God, thank you for Jesus. Lord, I pray for those who have been hurt from the attacks of the enemy, who've lost children, who lost family, who've done everything they know to do. And Father, I pray that you bring them healing in their hearts. Give them encounters, O God. You are God of your word. And I thank you for releasing healing right now to the brokenhearted. Jesus, touch those. Set them free. Give them the revelation that you will not leave them as an orphan. You will come to them. Thank you, Father God, for doing this work. You know, I used to hold back tears, but I don't hold them back anymore. I let the compassion of God come out. I let the real power of God through his love come out. Because there's a compassion that will come. So I began to stand on the scripture, Jesus, you won't leave me as orphan, you will come to me. The Lord began to give me healing, began to show me more things about himself. Then he took me to this next scripture because he had me go through and read Galatians, Ephesians, Philippians, Colossians every day for a long season of time. And so I read them over and over and over. And I still like going back and reading them because I still find new things and life that comes out of it. But we're going to turn to Galatians 4, verse 6. And I'm probably going to read 1 through 6. But I want to highlight the scripture. Because when we're talking about, and this is where I want to bring this, as we're talking about these points and these things that God wants to reveal, how we need to break the spirit of unbelief was the first one, through the word. And then as we're going, I was sharing about what's lacking in our faith, in our encounters and our experiences, that God wants to show himself to us, that the Lord wants to perfect what's lacking in our faith. So the second point that I wanted to bring to the table is the Lord is taking us on a growth process till we are perfected. So we need to get out, the first thing, we need to get out the unbelief so that we can have perfect faith. And I had shared about how sometimes we can have some unbelief, but we still have faith. We need to get that lack out, and we do it through the teaching of the word again. But the point that I wanted to get here is dealing with unbelief, dealing with doubt, and sometimes in dealing with those things, we have to deal with the disappointments that we've experienced, with the battles that, you know, we've lost things. But as we get healed, there's a purpose. And I want to read, actually, we're going to start in chapter 4, verse 1. Now I say that the heir, as long as he is a child, does not differ all from a slave, though he is master of all, but is under guardians and stewards until the time appointed by the father. Even so we, when we were children, were in bondage under the elements of the world. But when the fullness of time had come, God sent forth his son, born of a woman, born under the law, to redeem those who were under the law, that we might receive the adoption as sons. And because you are sons, God has sent forth the Spirit of His Son into your hearts, crying out, Abba, Father. Therefore, you are no longer a slave, but a son, and if a son, then an heir of God through Christ. When Jesus said, I will not leave you as an orphan, I will come to you, there's something hidden in that statement. He wanted to bring us in as sons. He wanted to bring us into the adoption, to adopt us. So that we could experience the wonderful promises of God. Where it says you are no longer slave, but a son. See, when we are underneath the law of sin and death, we're a slave to that law. But the Lord is saying, no, I want to make you alive in Christ Jesus and put you under the law of the life, spirit of life through Christ Jesus, which through that we overcome the law of sin and death. But I want to return back to the first two scriptures in 1 and 2. It says, now I say that an heir, which we are an heir, we're no longer orphans, as long as he is a child, does not differ at all from a slave, though he is master of all. See, we've been told so much that we have authority over all the works of the enemy, which we do. We're told that we lay hands on the sick and they recover. These signs shall follow those who believe in my name. They'll cast out devils. They'll speak with new tongues. If they pick up serpents or drink any dead thing, it won't hurt them. They'll lay their hands on the sick and they'll recover. It's in Mark 16. But then we go out to do those things, to receive healing, and yet we experience some things that it seems like, Lord, what's going on? Our faith is lacking. We need the perfect faith to come. In verse 1, it says, you know, though they're master of all, that if we're a child, we don't have any difference in comparison to a slave. And then number 2, it says, but is under guardians and stewards until the time appointed by the Father. Now, when Christ came, he paid for everything. He gave us access to everything. We have the spirit of a son in our hearts crying out, Abba, Father. That's why I was bringing out this revelation of Jesus as the everlasting Father. That we have an adoption. We have a Father God who won't leave us as an orphan. He'll come to us. And we have it through Jesus. But if we are still children, we're not going to be able to walk into that. That's why there's a process of growth. Now, I'm mainly speaking to those right now watching online that are those that are a part of the body of Christ, that are children of God, sons and daughters of God, because we have all the precious promises available to us through Christ. And there is a way to grow into those things. Now, for so long, I was told, you know, we got authority, got to stand on the word, got to confess the word, and I had a lot of gaps and things I didn't understand. But I did not know that I could not walk into those things in fullness because I had a steward over me until I grew to maturity. That's why Paul is praying so many different prayers that we read of Paul, but one of them is, I travail in prayer again for you till Christ be established in you. He's talking about maturity. He's asking the Father when he's praying in Ephesians chapter 1 to give him a spirit of wisdom and revelation so they may know. And we talked Sunday about knowing the hope of our calling. And then we're going to go on and talk about the riches of glorious inheritance of the saints in the incomparable great power to us who believe. See, if we don't know who we are, we can't walk into the things of God. If we're not mature in Christ, then we're under the elements of the world. We're subject to them. Part of the growth process in Christ is knowing who we are as sons and daughters of God in Christ Jesus. What is available to us? It comes through a relationship with our God, Jesus, our everlasting Father. And I'm just going to read off a few things about being a son of God. In Romans 8:14, it says, "As for as many as are led by the Spirit of God, these are the sons of God." And actually, I just feel like that's all I'm going to share as far as the sonship aspect, because we had a lot of teaching about sonship. Lots of teaching about things on being sons and daughters of God, you know, kings in the kingdom. But the next question I believe the Lord is bringing up is, how do we get there? How do we get to mature sons and daughters? When I was going through and learning about Jesus not leaving me as an orphan, I was learning about Jesus through the Word. And then I would encounter Jesus. See, part of growth is the manifestation of Christ in our lives. We read in 1 Corinthians 3:18 about, as we behold, we become. There has to be an encounter with Christ so that we can grow. But we grow thereby through the Scriptures. See, there's an aspect of we're being changed from glory to glory, but also talks about in Romans where 12, where it says, "Be transformed by the renewing of your mind." So there's a renewal of the mind aspect. There is a being transformed by the glory of God aspect. And there is a maturity that comes through the Word of God growing mightily and prevailing in Scripture in our lives. When I begin to see all these truths of how I needed to break unbelief through the Word, because I needed to encounter who Jesus really was and who He really is, I begin to get breakthrough. And then as I begin to take that next step in discovering who He is and not leaving me as an orphan, I begin to get more boldness back again. Because no matter where I'm at, He doesn't leave me. Now, I know a lot of times we've heard that, but do you know it? And sometimes, you know, I hear, you know, as I'm preaching, this question is coming up. Well, what does this have to do with healing? Well, it has everything to do with it. If there's anything between you and Jesus, He's not going to be able to do a mighty work in your life because you won't let Him. One of the reasons why I read the scripture about He could do no mighty works there was more than just breaking the spirit of unbelief. He was saying if we have any offense towards Jesus in any way, that can hinder the flow of healing in our lives. And we have found many times that unforgiveness can hinder growth, hinder healing in our lives. Now, I don't want to go too much about the unforgiveness part right now. But if you're looking to get healing and you have unforgiveness towards the Lord, I would ask you to lay that down, because the Lord isn't our enemy. He's our answer. Jesus is the cure. And a lot of times in my life when I hadn't experienced healing or I suffered loss, I got offended at Jesus. So I had to go through a process of forgiving the Lord for something I thought that He did or didn't do. But when I asked Him later about these things, He made a statement to me. So, "Lord, why didn't you do anything?" And He said, "I've done everything. How much more do you want me to do than to take all sickness and sin and disease?" He said, "By stripes we were healed." He said He took it, sickness on Himself, all the pain, all these different things. And I said, "Oh, yeah, I guess that's true." So when I began to hear these things, God was positioning for healing. He was preparing me for this encounter of healing in my life. Sometimes before we can get bodily healing, we need to work through some stuff. Because it says Jesus came to heal the brokenhearted, and set the captive free, to proclaim the favorable year of the Lord. See, Jesus has come to bring good news. But he's not just concerned about your body, and he's not just concerned about your broken heart. He's concerned about bringing you to the place of joint heir in Christ, sons and daughters of God. He was the firstborn among many, and you're one of these many. And he wants you to become a son of God in full maturity. Jesus, the everlasting Father, is giving us a picture that he's a father of what? He's a father of many sons, many brethren. And we need to be mature. I want to read another thing that goes along with this line. You probably have heard this story before. We're going to turn to Matthew 17, 14 through 20. And it said, when they had come to the multitude, a man came to him, kneeling down to him and saying, Lord, have mercy on my son, for he is an epileptic and suffers severely. For he often falls into the fire and often into the water. So I brought him to your disciples, but they could not cure him. Then Jesus answered and said, O faithless and perverse generation, how long shall I be with you? How long shall I bear with you? Bring him here to me. And Jesus rebuked the demon and cast out, and it came out of him, and the child was cured from that very hour. Then the disciples came to Jesus privately and said, Why could we not cast it out? So Jesus said to them, Because of your unbelief, for surely I say to you, if you have faith as a mustard seed, you should say to this mountain, Move from here to there, and it will move. And nothing will be impossible for you. Isn't that amazing? Nothing shall be impossible for you. All you need is a little bit of faith. However, this kind does not go out except by prayer and fasting. Now, this accounts also in Mark 9, 4 through 29, and Luke 9, 37 through 41. I'm going to stay right here because we've been going for a while. But I want to make this point. Is this demon a prayer and fasting demon? How much do you have to pray? How much do you have to fast to get this out? Well, I've heard this taught many times in many different ways. And then I was listening to Dr. Johann about this, and I was like, oh, finally. Who was he talking to? He was talking to the disciples, right? They asked him a question. Why could we not cast it out? Jesus gives them the answer. Because of your unbelief. Then he goes on and said, For surely, I say to you, if you have faith as a mustard seed, you will say to this mountain, Move from here to there, and it will move. Nothing will be impossible for you. For so long, I thought the statement of Jesus in verse 21 that we're about to read was applied to, this was the fasting demon. He was referring to this demon into the son of the boy that was suffering, saying, okay, this demon will only come out by prayer and fasting. But then after I got more teaching about the subject, that's not the case. See, Jesus was talking to the disciples about their unbelief. Because they asked them, why couldn't we cast it out? Jesus gives them the answer. your unbelief? Was he talking to the father's, the son, the kid that was severely demon possessed? No, he wasn't talking about that demon. He was talking about their unbelief. The reason why it wasn't coming out was not because it was a prayer and fasting demon, because Jesus had already given them in Matthew 10 power and authority, and we saw also in Luke 9 power and authority over all demons and all sickness and disease to cast them out. No, he was talking to them because he was letting them know that your unbelief is only going to come out by prayer and fasting. So it's not a prayer fasting demon. There's not these different classes that you got to pray specifically for this one in order for it to come out. Nope. That's not what he's talking about here. That's something that's been mistaught for long periods of time. What he's talking about here is this. You want the unbelief to get out of your life for the things that you are trying to do according to my word. You need to get into some prayer and fasting, so that the unbelief in your life can get out. So then you can operate like I've called you to do. Because when they asked Jesus, why could we not cast it out? He didn't say because that man's unbelief or his son's unbelief at this point in time. He did bring up they were a faithless generation and perverse. And in other accounts we see, and I'm going to read this statement or this scripture. We'll start in verse 17 in Mark. It says, then one of the crowd answered and said, teacher, I brought you my son who has a mute spirit, and wherever it seizes him, it throws him down. He foams at the mouth, gnashes his teeth, and becomes rigid. So I spoke to your disciples that you should cast it, that they should cast it out, but they could not. He answered and said to him, O faithless generation, how long shall I be with you? How long should I bear with you? Bring him to me. So they brought him to him, and when he saw him, immediately the spirit convulsed, and he fell on the ground, a wall of foaming at the mouth. So then Jesus asked the father, how long has this been happening to him? And he said, from childhood. And he goes on. So this is where Jesus speaks to the father. He says in verse 23, Jesus said to him, if you can believe, all things are possible to him who believes. And the father says, immediately the father of the child cried out and said with tears, Lord, I believe, help my unbelief. When Jesus saw that the people came running together, he rebuked the unclean spirit, said to it, death of dumb spirit, I command you, come out of him and enter him no more. Then the spirit cried out, convulsed with him greatly, and came out of him. And become as one as dead, so that many said he's dead. But Jesus took him by the hand and lifted him up, and he arose. Verse 28, and when he had come into the house, the disciples asked him privately, why could we not cast it out? See, the answer Jesus is giving is not for the Father, because he didn't ask him that question. The answer he's giving him is for the disciples, because they're wondering, why can I operate? So Jesus said to them, this kind comes out by nothing but prayer and fasting. See, this type of unbelief that we have in our heart needs some prayer and fasting at times. So I began to humble myself before the Lord and pray and fast about my lack of faith, what was lacking in my faith, that he would show me. In that process of time, the Lord began to show me scriptures about me being a son, that he would not leave me as an orphan, that he would come to me. He began to show me my position in Christ. So first he broke the unbelief. Second, he began to deal with my heart. And he began to show me who I truly am in Christ. He began to heal me. He began to break these things off. And so then as we begin to get into the Word, he gave me the how-to. How do we start to experience the things that God has told us to? Well, there's an aspect of prayer and fasting. The first aspect I told about breaking unbelief comes through Jesus taught the word. So we got to teach the word. We got to hear the word. Faith comes by hearing, hearing by the word of God. The next aspect is we have to deal with things of the heart. Our heart matters. The reason why Jesus came to heal the brokenhearted is because there's an aspect of our heart where rivers of living water come out of it. Our heart has so many aspects of things that if they're not in the right alignment and it's broken, it's hard for things to flow. Now, this is in the vein, or in the river of personal faith, which we're talking about tonight. One thing I love about Jesus is when he's talking to the Father, not to his disciples, although he was talking to all of them at the same time, but the Father asked him, Lord, I believe, help my unbelief. You know what Jesus did? He did. He helped his unbelief. Jesus was there for him. But this man recognized that he believed, but he had unbelief. I like to put that in that scripture in Thessalonians, revisit that one once again, to perfect what's lacking in your faith. See, the unbelief needs to be dealt with so that we can have that perfect faith. See, if you have that faith as a mustard seed, you can move mountains. Nothing is impossible to you. But if you have unbelief in the heart, it can hinder you. So how do we deal with the unbelief? The first thing to do dealing with unbelief is you have to get the scripture on it. Faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. We'll turn to some of these scriptures. Trying to see where we are in time. So Romans 10:17. So faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. We have to hear what God is saying. We have to know the scripture. We get faith through those aspects of things. Hearing the word of God. Now, what did Jesus tell that man with his son? I'm going to go back to it because I love to read these words. Verse 23, Jesus said, if you can believe, all things are possible to those who believe, or to him who believes. Jesus let him know that if he would just believe, that all things are possible to him. So when we're dealing with unbelief, we need to hear the word of the Lord. Part of praying and fasting that helps get rid of the unbelief in our life is so that we can be sensitive to hear what God is saying. Now, I'm not going to get into this too much right now, but we know that there's, in the Bible, in the Greek, it talks about the word rhema and the word logos. There's a lot of different aspects of that as far as different teachings I've heard. You know, when I first heard it, it was like, okay, well, the logos is the written word, and the rhema is the spoken word. And I kind of always struggle with those different things about how do I relate that. And then I heard given a different picture about how the logos is like the sun. It's all of the rhemas together. But then a rhema is like a shaft of light that comes to you that energizes you for that thing of God's word in your life. And so when we read the scriptures and we read about someone speaking to someone else, that was a rhema word that was recorded down in the scripture. That's a logos. That's, you know, it's the whole of the word. But then there's times when we need to hear. Faith comes by hearing. And then that word, it's rhema. Faith comes by hearing the word of God. We need to hear something. What I find in this, and how I like to describe it right now, we'll go into that more deeply later, is as you obey Jesus and you get in his word, right? You get in the scripture. You begin to start to see the logos. You got to see all these promises that are given to everyone else that belong to you. You begin to know who you are. But then there comes a time when you start to encounter Jesus and he makes it alive in you. And we had talked about different times about meditating on God's word. There's a time when we're speaking God's word, we're meditating it out to get the word of God in us. That process of getting the word into our hearts, into our spirits, into us. And then there's a part where it comes out, where we see that promise manifested. And that's when things begin to shift and change. And so the first thing that we need to do in overcoming unbelief is we got to know what God's word says about it. Faith comes by hearing and hearing by the word of God. The second thing we need to do about dealing with unbelief in our life is pray and fast so that we could hear God's word, so we have a heart open to receive. That was the cure that Jesus gave to his disciples for their unbelief. It wasn't to have to deal with anything with the demon in the sense that this wasn't praying fasting for the demon. It was praying and fasting for them because they already had power and authority over the demon to cast them out, to heal the sick. I have a story about Kenneth Hagin who talked about where the Lord was showing him that if the anointing lacked in his life, he was to pray and fast. And so that's another aspect of a man of God taking those things where God was telling him also, you got to pray and fast to deal with these things when the unbelief starts to try to creep up in your life. But the reason why we're praying and fasting in this healing session is we need to get the unbelief about what Jesus is saying in our lives and to us out. And I feel like the Lord wants me to finish with this parable. Actually, there's two of them. And it's in Luke 17. And then we're going to read another one. And it's going to be 17, 1 through 10. And then Luke 18. And it's going to be 1 through 8. So if you want to, you can go ahead and turn to Luke 17. Then he said to his disciples, "It's impossible that no offenses should come, but woe to him through whom they do come." Sorry about that. "It would be better for him if a millstone was hung around his neck and he were thrown into the sea than that he should offend one of these little ones. Take heed to yourself. If your brother sins against you, rebuke him. If he repents, forgive him. And if he sins against you seven times in a day and seven times in that day returns to you saying, 'I repent,' you shall forgive him." I end up deciding to read this passage about forgiveness, but I find it interesting because it's before this next passage. Verse 5, it says, "And the apostles said to the Lord, 'Increase our faith.' So the Lord said, 'If you have faith as a mustard seed, you can say to this mulberry tree, be pulled up by the roots and be planted in the sea, and it would obey you. And which of you having a servant plowing or tending sheep will say to him when he has come to the field, "Come at once and sit down to eat"? But will he not rather, say to him, 'Prepare something for my supper and gird yourselves and serve me till I have eaten and drunk, and afterwards you will eat and drink?' Does he thank the servant because he did the things that were commanded him? I think not. So likewise you, when you have done all those things which you are commanded, say, 'We are unprofitable servants. We have done what it was our duty to do.'" See, there's a place of getting the unbelief out, but there's a place of increase. And when I read this parable about increasing our faith, I found it very interesting because I was like, what does that even mean, Lord? I mean, increase our faith. And then he begins to talk about this relationship with his servants. I'm going to kind of repeat it kind of how I understood it. He was saying that, does a master come home and say, "Hey, what do you need to eat? What do you want me to do for you?" No. He says, first, you go get me something to eat and drink, and then I will then do something for you. I'll likewise do that to you. You serve me first, and then I will come to you, and I'll help you. I begin to get in the scriptures on this one. And I don't want to go in too much detail because I've been taking a lot of time as the Lord's been leading. But what I have found is this. A lot of times we come to Jesus and we request, feed me. I'm hungry. Give me this. Give me that. And Jesus is like, what? No, no, no. You prepare something for my supper and gird yourself and serve me till I've eaten and drunk. And afterward, you will eat and drink. This is an aspect of knowing him as the master. So I've shared about knowing Jesus as the everlasting father. And I feel like led to add this on here to knowing Jesus as the master. See, when we want something from Jesus, he's telling us in this parable that there is an order of operation. See that? The order of operation is this. If you need something from God, you need to wait on him first, right? And then after you wait on him, sound like a scripture that we read before? Then after you wait on him, then he will come and he will serve you. See, when we want to increase our faith, it comes through a relationship, a right relationship with the master. When we come and sit at his feet and we serve him, we do what he requires and what he requests. And then he'll come back and do likewise. It's putting him in the right order. Now, I read before about those who wait on the Lord shall renew their strength. They'll mount up with wings like eagles. They run, they won't grow weary. They walk, they won't grow faint. And then there's another passage that talks about that the Lord is the only God who moves on behalf of those who wait for him. I love that. The only God who moves on behalf of those who wait for him. So Jesus is taking this and he's saying, okay, you want increased faith? Come and wait on me. Come to me. Serve me. And what I mean by serve him, what he's trying to get here, I believe, is humbling ourselves before him, worshiping and waiting on his feet. See, Jesus told his disciples before, he said he called those that he wanted, that he himself wanted, and they came to him. There's a process of coming to him. He's reminding them of this process. You come to me, wait on me. And then the next part of it, where he says, you know, so likewise you, when you have done all those things which I commanded you, say, we are unprofitable servants, we have done what is our duty to do. See, he begins to instruct them as they wait on what they're to do. Does that sound like a conversation, a rhema word that he's giving to his disciples on what they're to do? Right? He said, well, once you've done all these things, we're supposed to say we're unprofitable servants. There was a conversation that Jesus is telling them that they need to have with him on what they are to do. And that, when he speaks the word to them on what they're to do, that's where their faith will come. That's where the increase of faith will happen. And they're able to do what God tells them to do. But it comes through a conversation that he's having with them. So in this aspect of learning or meeting Jesus as our master and beginning to understand the order of operations that we need to come and we need to wait on God. See, healing isn't a reward. It really isn't. It belongs to us in the Bible. But it flows through Jesus. When Jesus, you know, talks about many different pictures of Jesus, and I've talked about this before, that Jesus is the door. Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through him. Jesus is risen from the dead. He's alive, seated at the right hand of the Father. We have to go through him to get anything. I also shared about in Ephesians where it talks about that we've been blessed with every spiritual blessing in heavenly places in Christ. Another time where this flow comes. But it's interesting that in this parable and what he's telling them is you come to me first and wait on me. The reason why I read this next one is because a lot of times when we come and wait on God, we have some problems, a lot of attacks of the enemy that comes against us. So in Luke 18, I'm going to read it real fast. It says, "And he spoke a parable to them that men always ought to pray and not lose heart, saying, there was in a certain city a judge who did not fear God nor regard man. Now there was a widow in that city, and she came to him saying, get justice for me from my adversary. And he would not for a while, but afterward he said within himself, though I do not fear God nor regard man, yet because this widow troubles me, I will avenge her, lest by her continual coming she weary me. Then the Lord said, hear what the unjust judge said. And shall God not avenge his own elect who cry out day and night to him, though he bear long with them? I tell you that he will avenge them speedily. Nevertheless, when the Son of Man comes, will he really find faith on the earth?" These go together. See, when you come to God, he's not saying he's unjust. He's using this example of a woman coming to an unjust person. We know God is just, kind, loving, but do you know that? Is he really a rewarder of those who diligently seek him? Is he a God of his word? That's why I talked about healing the heart before this time. Because when you suffer loss and you suffer different things, it's hard to believe. We got to deal with the unbelief. The first part we deal with is the hurts. The second part we deal with is the understanding. But he uses this lady who keeps coming. See, she's going through a test of faith. But she said, but Jesus said, how much more? I'm sorry, he says in verse 7, and shall not God avenge his own elect who cry out day and night to him, though he bears with them along with them? I tell you that he will avenge them speedily. See, there's a speedily aspect of God. When I had heard this parable before, it's always this waiting, going day and night, you know, this aspect. But all of a sudden you see at the end where Jesus is talking about speedily. God's going to avenge speedily. See, he's coming to change the mindset. You say, wait a minute. This guy she's coming day and night to is unjust. She's got to pound on the door, you know, harass him over and over and over. But then at the end when he's talking about our God, who we come to, talks about those who cry out day and night to him, will he not avenge them speedily? Never saw that before, where God wants to do a work speedily for us. But this next statement is powerful. He says, nevertheless, when the Son of Man comes, will he really find faith on the earth? That can be interpreted a lot of different ways. When he comes back, second coming, will he find faith on the earth? I believe that's true. But it didn't say when he comes back. It says when he comes. So let's turn back to the scripture we started with in John chapter 18. I mean chapter 14, verse 18. It says, I will not leave you as orphans. I will come to you. Will he find faith when he comes? Then in verse 21 it says, he who has my commands and keeps them is he who loves me, and he who loves me will be loved by my Father, and I will love him and manifest myself to him. I've read a lot of different Greek definitions and it says to let myself be clearly seen by him. Nevertheless, when the Son of Man comes, will he really find faith on the earth? See, Jesus comes and visits us all the time, whether we see him or not. He never leaves us or forsakes us. But what I wanted to communicate and what I feel like the Lord is saying here is he's not left you as an orphan. He will come to you. But when he comes, what is he going to find? There's this picture here that the Lord wants to come. He wants to meet with you. He wants to heal you. But he wants you to wait on him. And when he comes, will he find faith? When he comes, will he find faith? I'm going to start to close. But I've gone through all these different things and shared these different things because this is a journey the Lord has taken me on. Revelation of knowing God as our Father, knowing that we're children of God, where we're placed in the kingdom of God. But there's an aspect of when we're coming for healing for the Lord that we need to wait on him. And sometimes when we're waiting, we need to examine ourselves and pray and fast to get those things out of our heart that are preventing the belief that we need. That unbelief needs to come out, and we need to increase our faith by spending time with God. But there's this waiting aspect. We got to wait on him because we're his servants. Even though we're sons, we're also servants to Jesus. And I want to finish off with this scripture, and I'll close with a few things. But in Matthew 8, 16 and 17, when evening had come, they brought to him many who were demon-possessed, and he cast out the spirits with a word. And he healed all who were sick, that it might be fulfilled which is spoken by Isaiah the prophet, saying, he himself took our infirmities and bore our sicknesses. Now, I'm not going to burden you with all the debate about this thing, about, you know, but this is the truth. He took our sicknesses, our infirmities, and bore our sicknesses. This is the fulfillment of that, so that we can walk in it too. But I find it interesting that it was fulfilled in the evening time, which is about the same time of this parable. When Jesus is coming, you know, he's giving this picture of the servants needing to wait on him. But these people came to Jesus. That's the whole point here. A lot of times we're going and we're looking. I need to go to this healing service. I need to go here, which, yes, you can go there. But the reason why we go to different things is to meet Jesus, to get the healing. And he will bring about healing because he said so. He's no rewarder of, or no respecter of persons. He's the same yesterday, today, and forever. If he's willing to heal one, he's willing to heal you. But we find that this scripture is fulfilled, that he himself took our infirmities and bore our sicknesses. But they came to him and they brought to him these people. I read in the beginning where they were offended at him and only a few came to be healed. I don't want us to be offended with Jesus. Sometimes we watch online and we're like, okay, let's see what they got, because I've done that myself. Let's see what they got. Well, unfortunately, the only thing I can offer you is not a quick fix. But I'm going to offer you truth. See, I didn't get someone laying their hands on me and I get healed. I didn't get it through what I call the moving of the anointing. But God is going to do those things. But I'm giving you the surefire way every time to get healing. See, I was disappointed because I go and have people pray for me and I wasn't healed. But then Jesus, he's got a perfect record. There's never been anyone who came to Jesus to be healed that kept coming, that when Jesus responded to them, he was like, oh, I'm sorry. I guess the anointing wasn't here today. Oh, we'll come back next week. Or, you know, I can't do it because I need more prayer and fasting. Or whatever the excuse may be that we've heard. No, Jesus is 100%. He's the way, the truth, and the life. He's the healer. So when we come to Jesus, I experienced healing when I met him. I kept seeking after Jesus. I kept waiting for him. And when he came to me one day, there was faith there. I shared about my shoulder, how I was in this Home Depot trailer picking up a pallet, and I had already had surgery before, and I had gone and done everything I thought I could do, and I had been believing God and getting in the scripture, and I had been waiting on Jesus. I'd set aside time every day to wait on him. Jesus, I'm waiting for you. Here's what your word says. I'd wait. And so one day as I was in there, I dislocated my shoulder again. Popped it back in. And I was like, oh, Lord, what am I going to do? And I shared about that. I said, I don't care if angels have to come down from heaven to hold my shoulder together. It's just going to work. He found faith on the earth. And guess what? It just worked. When you get around Jesus continually, you seek after him. You wait on him, even though you might not see him or feel him, but do you believe what the word says in the scripture? I will not leave you as an orphan. I will come to you. He will come. And as you wait, you begin to experience the presence of Jesus, the life of God going into you, filling you up in that word, strengthening in your core, strengthening the spirit. And then the day comes speedily. I was healed. Jesus wants to do that for you. Now, we had prayed earlier about healing in the heart for loss. And I know that some of us might not have time to pray and fast, but that's okay. See, what I love about Jesus is he told the disciples, this comes out by prayer and fasting, but even though there was a lack of faith, he said, all things are possible to those who can believe. With the father, with the demoniac son, when that father said, I believe, help my unbelief, what did Jesus do? Did he say, well, I'm sorry. I mean, you're not ready. No, Jesus was there. And he healed him. And he set him free. See, when you have Jesus in the presence of Jesus, you might not have everything you need. You might be lacking in faith. You might not have it all perfect. But Jesus, when his presence is there to heal, when he shows up, when you encounter him, you will encounter the healer. He'll have enough for you. The life of God will flow from him to you. So in the conclusion, again, I think it's my third one. I want to pray because I want everyone to experience Jesus, the everlasting Father, Jesus, the Master, and Jesus, the Healer. As I was coming here, I was wondering, how is it I'm going to present him? It's an honor to preach the gospel of the kingdom of God. It's an honor to tell about Jesus. See, Jesus is alive. He's not dead. He's risen from the grave. He's sitting at the right hand of the Father, and he's sending us out to tell this message about himself. He says, how can someone believe unless they have a preacher or unless someone tells them? And, you know, how can someone preach or tell them without a preacher? And so the Lord wants us to know that he is alive and that these are the things about him. Paul said, I want to know Jesus Christ and him crucified. That's what I long to know. And then you see in the book of Ephesians where we're at right now, that he preached for 2 years and taught about the wonderful works of Jesus, about Jesus, the gospel of the kingdom of God, about Jesus. And I find it so important that when it comes to healing, we need to encounter Jesus. We need to know these aspects of Jesus. We need to deal with the heart. Because I wanted to go on to, you know, how do you move into more practical application of things? But the Lord kept on bringing me back to this time of dealing with things of the heart and waiting on Him. Because that's what we're doing in this time and season right now, is we're waiting on Him. Because He's going to show up in the first measure of the outpouring that's coming in, or that is coming in July. It will be present and He will be here. He's here right now. He wants to heal now. He wants you to encounter Him now. But in July, there's going to be greater encounters of Him. Right now, we just have a few, and here He is. We have lifted up the name of Jesus. I proclaimed Jesus Christ and Him crucified. I've shared about Jesus and the different aspects of Christ and what He's done and what He will continue to do. And I believe right now what the Lord wants to do is He wants to release healing, not just in our bodies, but in our hearts. And we had prayed that earlier. But I'm going to pray, and I feel led to add this aspect. Jesus wants you to encounter Him. He doesn't want you to be left as an orphan. Because orphans don't know their fathers anymore. There's a lot of different things that happen with an orphan. Sometimes they are forsaken and thrown away. Sometimes their parents are lost. But either way, there's a lack of connection with the father. That's why they're an orphan. He doesn't want that anymore with you. He says, I didn't come to leave you as an orphan. I will not leave you as an orphan. I will come to you. So I'm going to pray that the Lord come to you, that He doesn't leave you as an orphan according to His word, that you experience this revelation and encounter with Jesus. So Father, I thank You for Your word. Thank You for all the things that have been shared tonight. There's so many of them. But Father, the one thing I ask that You do tonight is that You would manifest Jesus to everyone here and everyone watching online, that they may know Jesus, the healer, the master. Oh, Father, that they may know Your Son, Jesus, the everlasting Father. So, Father, right now in the name of Jesus, I release healing. I command sicknesses to go. I command demons to leave in Jesus' name. Father, I ask You to open up eyes that they may see Jesus, the healer. I ask You to send out a spirit of wisdom and revelation and knowledge of You, that the eyes of their understanding would be enlightened, that they may know the hope of Your calling, the riches of Your glorious inheritance in the saints, and Your incomparable great power towards us who believes. Father, lift up Jesus. Let the word of God grow mightily and prevail. I see a foot right now that's looks like there's something wrong with the toes, that they're positioned wrong. In the name of Jesus, I command you to straighten out and to be healed. I see livers, more than one. In the name of Jesus, I command you to function properly. All the damage, I command you to leave, and I command life to come and to be healed in Jesus' name. Oh, Lord. I see someone with arthritis, their joints in their hands, in their elbows. It's even in their shoulders and their shoulder blades. In the name of Jesus, I set you free right now. Be healed. Arthritis, let go. Jesus, I ask you to touch them with your life. Fill them right now. be healed in the name of Jesus. I see a group of ladies praying. There's more than one of them. And they're praying to encounter the Lord deeper. Father, I'm asking you that you would send Jesus to manifest himself to them. That you have not left them as orphans, that you come to them. I see a fire spreading throughout the east coast of America, like we've seen before. Father, I see it again. I just declare right now, laborers to go to the north, the south, east, and west to proclaim Jesus Christ. Lord, send laborers into the harvest. Open up the eyes of the blind. Set the captives free. Open up the door for the word. I feel the Lord is done with our online session of healing and revelation, really, of Jesus. But to everyone's here, I'll open up the altar if you want prayer for anything, for prayer or anything. And just want to encourage everyone to continue waiting on Jesus, because you will encounter and you will experience the Word of God. Jesus is the healer, and Jesus is healing you. Jesus will heal you, and he's willing and he's able. Just want to sign off of that. Encourage the church throughout all the world to press into Jesus and to be encouraged through the word. Goodbye.